When I was 12 years old, I went to a little camp in southern Oregon called Tadmore. After Cry Night, anybody know what Cry Night is? Nobody knows what Cry Night is? Anybody go to summer camp or church camp? It's usually the night when everybody gets all excited, and there's usually a special guest comes in, and everyone gets crying, and everybody gets saved. Okay? That's Cry Night. All right? It usually happens the night before the last day. All right? It was Thursday night, and it was Friday when I made my decision to accept Christ. I went down by the lake, counselor joined me, and I received Christ at that point. I had been seeking, and at church camp, I found it. Later that summer, I was baptized at my church, little church in Troutdale, Oregon. And that's basically my story. That's all my conversion to receive Christ was. What was important was what's happened since then. You see, my parents got divorced, my best friend died, and I kind of went the other way. The decisions I made were destructive. I would go to church, but it was usually to pick up girls. After a couple of failed marriages, my two youngest children being born before wedlock, my wife, my girlfriend at the time and I went to a little church called Coral Baptist Church. Anybody ever heard of that? No? Anyone's ever heard of Coral Baptist Church? Little church on University Drive just south of Riverside. It's the roots for this church. This church is Church by the Glades. It's actually Coral Baptist Church, DBA, doing business as Church by the Glades. So it was a few years ago. Wow, that's a little much, guys. Can we do something about it?
No, we put something in front of you. They're like, hey, borrow that.
That's very blue, huh?
Yeah. Just momentary, sorry.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Thank you very much, Gary. We went to Coral Baptist Church, where we were introduced to and married by Herschel Priestman. Herschel Priestman was an incredible pastor. He was the predecessor to David, and he had a knack for remembering names. He saw you for the first time and he would remember your name. He met my parents. They came from Portland, Oregon to visit once. He met them. The next time he saw them, which was at this church, he remembered their names. I think it's all. Okay. He remembered their names. It was like 3 years had passed. And he remembered their name. Okay. So I was married by Herschel. We got involved in Bible study. We got involved in volunteering. We really submerged ourselves in the Word. My second Bible study teacher was Larry Pettit. When I met him, and the first time we went to his Bible study class, we knew we were home. Although I live in Christian life, I had not asked for forgiveness for the wrongdoings that I had done as a young man. In July of 2011, I rededicated my life to Christ, and I asked for forgiveness for those things I had done when I was a younger man. And I promised not to make those mistakes again. See, that's where we get to the point where we actually are repentance happens. When we decide not to do what we had done, the sin that we had done, we run from it. We repent from it. In July of that year, I was double dipped. I was baptized again. And this time it was with the help of my older son, Jonathan. It was a wonderful day. Being baptized with your own child. It was great. That's my salvation story. But what's important is what was done after I was saved. God still used me even though I was out of sorts with him. When we talk about Jesus, we plant seeds. I shared the gospel with strangers without shame. People are looking and wanting All we need to do is talk about our Jesus. They're listening. When you go out to eat, pray. Don't be ashamed to thank God for your meals. If you do it at home, why not do it out in the restaurant? Okay? I have friends that are not Christian. When I eat at their home, we say grace. That's them honoring me because they know where I stand. And the only reason they know where I stand is I live the life that Christ gave me to live. I ask that of you. Pray when you visit people in the hospital. People are listening. Pray when people are going in for surgery. Pray when you're out visiting grandparents in nursing homes or visiting other people. Pray. And pray in Jesus' name. Let me close with an experience that happened to me. As you're all aware, I'm in a wheelchair. I wasn't always. I broke my back in 1997 and a back surgical back in 2001. When I woke up from that back surgery and realized I was paralyzed, they had to put me back to sleep because I freaked out. I was alone. And they had to go in and operate again. And when they did, when I woke up, I knew I was okay because the first face I saw was Larry Pettit's. It was like 1 a.m, something crazy like that. It was well after midnight. And we prayed. We prayed. Even though we were thanking God for a broken body, we prayed. And we were heard. When I was in rehab, I had several roommates. One roommate, an 86-year-old Jewish gentleman, with cervical cancer. He had cancer in his neck. He was paralyzed from the neck down, and he couldn't swallow. He couldn't move anything. He could barely talk. At nights, he would wake up wanting something, and it was usually water. And he would add a little tube that he'd put near his mouth, and he would blow in it, and he would call a nurse. Well, the nurse staff got tired of him doing this night after night after night, several times a night, so they moved it just far enough away where he couldn't reach it.
Oh, wow.
This gave me an opportunity. When he woke up, he would scream, which woke me up, of course, and I would ask him what he wanted. Usually it was water. I would have to explain to him what his situation was, and that he couldn't have it because he couldn't swallow it. And I would ask him if I could pray with him. Larry taught me years ago, when you're talking with Jewish people, Stuart, you talk Old Testament, right? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I would pray, and I would pray with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And he understood that. One day, his daughter and his wife would come in every day and see him, and one day they came in, and Leslie came around the corner, and she said, "I'm a shy person, but I was felt led to come and talk to you. I've heard you talking to your Bible study teacher, and I've heard you talking about Bible study and about church, and we would pray." She said, "I heard you talking to your surgeon and your doctors." She says, "I'm a Messianic Jew." She's a saved Jew. And her prayer was that none of her family members would die before they met Jesus. She said she felt come to talk to me. And she asked if she could pray for me, which she did in Hebrew. I didn't understand a word that she said, but I felt every single word. It's a beautiful language, and it still gives me chills to this day when I think about it, and I think about Leslie. One Tuesday, Leslie and her mom had come in and asked Mr. Siegel what he wanted to talk about, because that's all he would do. They would sit and talk, and they would talk for hours. And he said, "I don't care. So Leslie picked her favorite subject. Guess what it was? Jesus. So she started talking to him. And you know when you're in a hospital room and the curtain's drawn and that's supposed to be a ironclad wall so you don't have any idea what's going on the other side? And it's so hard to not listen when you're there by yourself, so you hear everything that's being said. At one point I heard Mr.
Especially Shigal, when you turn the TV down.
Well, yeah. At one point I heard Mr. Shigal say, you know, that's true. I know that's true. And Leslie stopped. He said, what's that, Dad? And she said, he said, Jesus is Messiah. She said, are you ready to meet him? I mean, are you ready to accept him, to receive him? He said, get gone. That day, I learned to transfer out of my bed into my wheelchair by myself for the first time. Let me tell you something. I got out of my chair. I got out of my bed and into my chair as quick as I could, and I grabbed my Bible off my nightstand. And this is where we went. I love my Bible. I love my paper Bible. Looked at my glasses. And you know, all it is, it's a book. And if you're not reading your Bible and marking it up, then you probably need to think about what you're doing with your Bible. God will forgive you for writing it. I promise. We went to Romans 10, 8. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. This is the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls upon his name, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's Romans 10, 8 through 13. Mark it in your Bible. Mark it in your Bible. That's Romans Road. Mary taught me how to walk down Romans Road years ago. It was Tuesday. It was a glorious day. Thursday came, which was even more glorious. And we woke up, and I woke up, and discovered Mr. Shigal met Jesus 2 days after receiving him. How important is that person laying next to you or that sees you on a daily basis? A co-worker, a friend, a brother, a parent. Take the time to pray out loud. Don't be ashamed. Let's pray. Dad, thank you for sending your son to save us from our sins. Thank you for telling us to go out to all the nations preaching your word. I know seeds are what some need to plant. Others need to water, yet others need to harvest. Thank you for this class as we learn your word and learn to love you more every time we meet. You and Pastor Larry, as we learn more about you and how we should witness for you so others can join us in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.